Good morning, a really warm welcome to those of you who are here in person at Holy Trinity this morning, and too to those who will be watching this afternoon online, wherever you are. We have been praying for you and for them. Alleluia! Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia!
Yesterday I was crucified with Christ. Today I am glorified with him. Yesterday I was dead with Christ. Today I am sharing in his resurrection. Yesterday I was buried with him. Today I am waking with him from the sleep. A moment of quiet reflection as we come to a time of confession. God of mercy, we acknowledge that we are all sinners. We turn from the wrong that we have thought and said and done, and are mindful of all that we have failed to do. For the sake of Jesus, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and help us to live each day in the light of Christ our Lord. Amen. And so may God our Father forgive us our sin and bring us to the fellowship of his table with the saints forever. Amen. And the prayer for this week, the collect. Almighty God, whose Son Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life, raise us who trust in him from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that we may seek those things which are above, where he reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Oh,
This is what Paul writes to the church in Ephesus. So I tell you this, and I insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. You, however, did not come to know Christ that way. Surely you heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbour, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May I speak in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I wonder if you sometimes look at a Bible passage, say for a Bible study or to do a talk, and think, well, that says all that needs to be said. Why say more? Isn't the original word of God enough? This really, I think, is from Ephesians, is a case in point. It's all about good behaviour. We all know how to behave as Christians, don't we? Well, that was my first thought when I looked through this passage earlier this week, but on further reflection, it seems to me that that's exactly the point that Paul is making here to the church in Ephesus, and maybe the message that we need to hear today. We need reminding, we need renewal. You'll know from previous weeks that Paul starts his letter to the Ephesians praising them for their faith in Jesus, and for their love for all God's people. But then he immediately goes on to say he's praying for them to know God better, that they may grow in the Spirit. And in the passage that I just read, he hints that all is not right in their community. They're still influenced by pagan lifestyles of the Gentiles, as he calls them, and in this case, he means the majority of the Ephesus population who have not yet been won for Christ. They, he says, those Gentiles, indulge in every kind of impurity because of their ignorance and hard-heartedness. And some of that is rubbing off, he thinks, on this young church. So he says, Paul says, you need to put off your old selves and be made new. Twice, at least he uses that phrase, put off, as if we were talking about an old coat or some other garment. Later in chapter 6, he writes about putting on the whole armour of God to protect against temptations. You remember the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of salvation, and so on. No doubt we'll be hearing more about that in a later talk in this sermon series, but I will just say this, that Adrian Plass has a fine reflection on it in his book, An Alien, that St. Wilfrid's This is what he writes. I have to say, dear friends, that I don't find these items hanging in my spiritual wardrobe. Instead, I find the white fronts of weariness, the knickers of non-involvement, the long johns of lust, the drainpipe trousers of drunkenness, and the balaclava of bewilderment. I wear all these things at the same time, and I feel utterly wretched and ridiculous. Well, it's no wonder, is it? Maybe some of you recognize these spiritual garments and the need of reclothing from time to time. Because inasmuch as we can't keep from sinning, we need to keep repenting and renewing ourselves and putting on those fresh clothes. In the passage that I read, the list of things that Paul says we need to put off is slightly different from Adrian Placid, but equally negative. Anger, theft, bad language, brawling, every form of malice, vengeance. And in later verses, he goes on to sexual immorality and drunkenness. So he's focusing now on the physical, the practical manifestations of spiritual poverty. Not just the things that we might feel, but the things that other people might actually see and recognize in our outer appearance and our behavior. Paul says, even though you are now followers of Christ, you still need to guard against sliding back into these old ways. Well, I've just read a commentary that has about 6 pages on each of these practical hints and tips for behaving well. So I'm just going to pick out 1 or 2 brief thoughts. Anger. There is a thing, righteous anger, such as might be felt, for instance, in the present times, at the plight of children in Syria, or the Uyghurs in Western China, or most recently those postmasters and postmistresses who've been so disgracefully treated in our own country. That's a form of anger which, if turned into action to help those people who are suffering, is a good thing. That's like the anger of Jesus against the Pharisees who condemned him for healing on the Sabbath day, or those who fleeced the worshippers at the temple. But anger that's just an expression of wounded pride or inconvenience is a different matter. Theft. It's not just burglary. It's not just pilfering or forgetting. Paying something? Are we always honest in our work or in our business dealings? Do we fill in our tax forms properly? Lots of ways of being thieves. Bad language, unwholesome language. There are many ways in which the spoken word can be used in a bad way. It includes gossip, not just swearing. I'm sure you all know the story of the gossipy person who was taken to the top of a church tower by a priest and told to empty a bag of feathers into the wind. Then the priest says, "Now go and collect them all up." And the person says, "That's impossible." And the priest says, "Yes, that's my gossip. A spoken word, you know, one of those things that don't come back, to be treated very cautiously." And there's more, of course. I'm sure that in this company there's no need for any lecturing from me on sexual immorality or drunkenness, by and large. But what a sad thing it is. What a sad thing it is. That in these last few years, the Church of England itself has been revealed as a place of toxic place of sexual abuse, just as much as any other institution. I really pray that with the work that's going on now, we can see the master of that. But one such instance undoes the work of hundreds, if not thousands, of evangelists in bringing people to Jesus. So Christian behavior that attracts people to Jesus, isn't just a matter of not doing the wrong things. It's not just controlling our anger. It's going overboard with kindness and compassion. It's not just being honest. It's going overboard with generosity. It's not just keeping a civil tongue. It's going overboard with praise and encouragement to our fellows, our fellow Christians, and everybody that we meet. So there's no better summary than the last verse of the reading as it appears in the beginning of chapter 5. The imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Amen.
In the words of the Nicene Creed, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sin he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection and the life of the world to come. Amen. And so let us pray. Father, we pray for the mission and ministry of your church worldwide. Pray especially for our own part of it, this diocese of Liverpool, for our bishops, Paul and Abbott, for their ministry at this time, for our cathedral, for Dean Sue and her team, and for this deanery. Sefton North, we pray for Anne Taylor and Andrew Cox as they lead us. We pray especially for the appointment of a new lay chair for our new synod. Pray that in this time of transition we might be outward looking in our mission. And so we pray, direct our hearts, O Lord, to love you more and more. As in this nation we are looking forward to moving into a new phase with COVID, where people are able to meet well and infection rates are dropping. We pray for the nation of India, seemingly overwhelmed at this time. And I particularly want to pray for those pastors who are serving the churches in the shanties of Hyderabad. Lord, for your resourcing of them. And two for Bishop Reuben Mark and his team in Caranaga Diocese. I pray especially for the work of those evangelists who are working in remote parts of that area. Lord, we pray for your resourcing, for a fair share of resources, and a just share. Lord, in your mercy, and Lord, we pray for those for whom we are concerned at this time. For loved ones who are isolated, who we cannot still see. For those who are hurting. For those who are fearful, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for those to be more. And especially this week, we remember the royal family still. And especially Andrew Phillips and his family as they mourn about. And for a deep faith in your victory over the power of sin and death and hell. And for your comfort. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. So we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power of the Lord, forever and ever. Amen.
Oh, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and King and Saviour. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you all, now and always. Amen. With the power that raised Jesus from the dead at work within you, go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia.
Garth is going to bring us his Bible reading.